I don't know if it's coming through or not. Oh, yay! Yes, it's coming through. Okay. All right, good. Sorry, guys. I have no idea what happened. I had to, like, restart my, like, computer program that does the streaming. I have no idea what was going on. Anyway, and I'm also trying out this thing where I put your tweets on the screen. I don't know. I don't know what's going on, but anyway, we're going to try this. So, okay. I'm going to go ahead and get some brush markers out just so I can get started on this. And then as I start doing a quote or something, then I can answer some questions. Okay, so I'm just going to use a Tombow marker with a brush tip. I'm just going to do some lettering. I don't think I'm going to do anything really special yet. I think I'll just pick out a quote from this book. Okay, this book is totally cute. I bought it in a hotel gift shop. I just thought it was adorable. Okay, hold on. I've got some weird webcam stuff going on, so let me check this, make sure it's working. All right, so we're just going to... Okay, no, we do want that. Okay, is it going to change? Oh, dang it. Sorry, guys. Most of the time I have all of this figured out, but I had to, like, restart the program. So I have no idea what's going on. And my camera has moved, it looks like. Sorry, guys. There we go. Now it's a little more straight on. Okay, so see how it changes, how it gets lighter? Let's get darker. Let's get lighter. Let's get darker. Okay. Sorry, bear with me for a minute. I'm going to try to get this figured out. Okay, there we go. Now it should be static. Whew! Okay. Alright, guys. Okay, so this is the book that I found in a hotel gift shop. It's called Friends Are Good. It's super cute, this little tiny book. I'm pretty sure you're supposed to, like, give it as a gift to someone, but it has really great quotes, like, friendship is a great place. I'm glad we're here. Such a fun quote. So maybe I'll just do that one since that one's the first one in the book. And I'm going to grab some scratch paper. I just have this big stack of, like, computer paper over here because that's how I roll. That's how I practice. Oh, sorry, guys. Got to watch it. Got to make sure I stay in focus here. Okay, so friendship is a great place. I'm glad we're here. So a lot of you have asked, like, what can I do to learn calligraphy or brush lettering or anything like that? And really, I can only tell you how I learned, which was trying to be observant, like trying to see styles out there that I love, and then, you know, trying to recreate them myself, if that makes sense. Let me try to turn that off so we can see. It's not gonna let me. Okay, well, whatever. Just trying to recreate what other people have done. So that's what I like to do a lot. And then just practice, you know, like, I shared on Instagram and Facebook this week that sometimes I like to do, like, word fill-in puzzles. And I do that because it gives me a chance to try out different lettering styles, you know, all caps or lowercase, or it just gives me a chance to try out different things. So it's a really great thing to do. So any chance you have to do some practicing is great. So I like to do it when I'm watching movies or, you know, maybe catching up on some YouTube videos or things like that. Something where I can listen instead of having to pay attention completely, if that makes sense. Okay. Now I'm not feeling so flustered after all the technical difficulties. So hopefully... Okay, so that's kind of messy, but that's okay. Once again, that was a Tombow marker. All right, let's do some questions. Okay. Justin asks, what do you normally do on the inside of a card if you use a dark colored cardstock to make your card? I either use a white gel pen or I cut out, you know, some of this cheap white paper and put that inside so that I have somewhere to write. That's basically what I do. Okay. Let's see. It says, your YouTube card videos are always perfect. Do you have to start over much? Chance for a blooper reel. No blooper reel, because I always delete everything after I've edited the video. But yeah, sometimes I make mistakes, and you know, I'll usually comment on it and say something. You're like, oh, I had to do this a few times before I was able to get this right, or this is the fifth time I've made this card, or something like that. A lot of it ends up on the cutting room floor. Edit a lot out. So that's where a lot of it ends up, thankfully. Okay, I'm going to grab some cardstock here to do some lettering. I've got a bunch of cardstock. Some of it's used, some of it's not. Like, here's one that never ever saw the light of day, because I realized it wasn't really easy to read. So I ended up doing something different for this quilt. This was a quilt, like, I think it was back in April, maybe even. But I kept it. Here's another of the Instagram ones. And then practice. Oh, I think this was when I did a periscope. And these were people's names. And just more practice. There's the one that I actually shared on Instagram. You know, I'm going to see if I can turn off this Twitter thing right now when I'm not using it. I thought I could. Oh, I know how. Ha ha! Okay, there we go. Sorry. Learning new live stream programs. It's always difficult. Okay, so I'm going to grab some blank cardstock here. And I'm so, like, flustered, like, not knowing what I'm doing. So sorry, guys. This might not be archived on my channel. Good example. Okay, some gray cardstock here. It does not want to focus. Focus, camera! Focus. Okay, come on. Come on. You can see my nails. Okay, come down here. There we go. Okay. It has issues focusing. I don't know what the deal is. Okay, so Person asks, current favorites of whatever. Oh, it's hard. Because things change. Current favorites, like crafting supplies? That's hard. Gosh. Still really loving watercolor. As far as, oh gosh, this is hard on the spot. Your current favorite ink. The inks that I'm really using a lot, as far as dye ink, I'm really loving, I do love the stamp inks, but I'm also really loving the W+9 inks, which is of a similar formula, but it has different color, more toned colors. They're really pretty. So I really love the W+9 inks, and I haven't used them for too much in video, so I need to break them out. As far as like some sort of tool or something, you guys saw me use the Fuse tool in my video on Monday. I've been really loving that. Okay, so here's another book that I use for calligraphy stuff. Thanks to You, compiled and written by Amelia Riedler. Anyway, it's got some great quotes in here. Some are really long. But, you know, like, thanks to you for the care you always show. I think I did this one as a quote. It's not how much we give, but how much love we put into giving. It's a really good quote. Okay. Okay, I'm not sure exactly what this person's question is. Okay, how did you land the awesome job at Stampin' Up! And Simon, and how does it feel looking back at the beginnings from now. I was hired at Snap and Up straight out of college. I think I found their job opening on monster.com. I don't even know if that website's still around, but I just found their Monster and applied. That's how I got my job there. And then as far as Simon goes, a mutual friend recommended me to Heidi, the owner of Simon, because they needed some design work done. And so I initially was brought on to just do some small design work, and then that morphed into doing product design as well. So it's not like they found me on the internet or anything. Purely, just like any other job, you have to apply. Yeah, that's how I got hired at both places. I hope you guys are liking seeing the question on screen. That's why I like the program that I'm using for these live streams, because I wanted to make sure you could like see people's questions. I don't like how it's formatted, like that space in between their name and the question, but you know, whatever. Another question. What is the difference between distress markers and distress inks? Is it just the form they're in? I know for a fact that the ink that's in the ink pads is not the same ink that is in the markers. It's formulated a little bit differently so that it can be in the form. With that being said, they both work with water fairly well. I started out watercoloring a lot with markers, but then switched over to just using the ink pads and like smushing them on a slick surface. And I did that because I realized that I wanted more color than the markers were giving out. Like, you can sit there and marker, or you can just smush an ink pad down and have it all at once. Does that make sense? So I could get a little bit of a stronger color with the ink pads. And also with the ink pads, you have the re-inkers. So you can re-ink the ink pads, or you can just use the actual ink from the re-inker bottles. So it's a little more concentrated. There's a lot of different things you can do with the ink pads. So I tend to use the markers only for like spot coloring, or if I'm gonna color on a stamp and then stamp it. I mostly use the ink pads exclusively now. Okay. Someone's saying the Twitter feed and Black Banner are blurry. That's probably because of the quality that's streaming through on your computer. So you might want to check the little gear in the bottom corner and see if you can up that so that you can see it a little bit more clearly. Okay. Lots of people from all over the world, Australia, Japan. Awesome. Pale Charcoal asked, would you ever consider giving away any of your brush lettering? I'm getting fingerprints all over this. Maybe, possibly, I don't know. I think I'd have to figure out what I would want to do for that. Okay, this person asks, is there another thing or substitute for heat embossing? Oh gosh, well, it depends on what you're trying to do. Because if you're doing like white or metallic heat embossing over a dark cardstock, you might be able to get away with using a really opaque pigment ink instead of embossing. But embossing is kind of like its own thing. Like, I don't know if you can really substitute anything for it, if that makes sense. I'm not entirely sure. Okay, let's see. This person asks, what do you like to buy at craft stores when you get a chance, like Michael's? I usually just wander through and I look at a lot of tools, because sometimes tools are hard to buy online. So I'll look for tools. What else would I buy at Michael's? To be honest, I only run to Michael's if there's something I need right away and I can't wait for it to be shipped from an online store. I'm one of those people that I'm walking through the brick and mortar store, and there's this feeling inside of me that's like, where's the search bar? I want to search to find whatever I need. Like, seriously, I've been in Target walking around. I'm like, oh, where's the search bar? And then I'm like, wait a minute. This is real. This isn't online. It's real life. You can't use a search bar. The most you can do is, like, grab an employee and ask them. That's so funny. So if I go somewhere, I usually already have an idea of what I'm going to buy. So, but sometimes, like, I think the last time I was in Michael's, it was months and months and months ago. I mean, I think it was, like, January or maybe even before Christmas. And I went in to get, what was it? Oh, to get wire cutters to cut apart dies. And while I was in there, I saw, what did I see? It was some embossing folders, I think. I just glanced around. Like, I didn't need anything in particular except for those wire cutters. But that's kind of like what my trips to stores look like. Okay, so this one says, a good deed is never lost. I think that's a pretty good quote. So maybe we'll do that one. I'm just going to use this metallic marker. I don't know how to pronounce this name. But it's the one that I had a brush lettering video a while back. Okay, so I've got to get this to stay open somehow. A good deed is never lost. Okay, I'm going to do this up and down, actually. Sorry if I stop talking while I'm doing this. I just find it really hard to talk and spell words correctly at the same time. Is never lost. I feel like I need to turn on some royalty-free music for you guys while I do this, because you're so used to seeing videos with music in the background when I'm not talking. I love doing writing on darker cardstock. I think it's just so fun. This is by Saint Basil the Great, or Basil. I'm not sure how to say that. Okay. There we go. That was pretty fast. The thing that's kind of fun about doing stuff like this is that after you've done it for a long time and you kind of know, you can kind of plan your spacing, it goes really fast. Okay. Let's see. Another question. I'm such a huge fan. I just wanted to know, do you have any advice for someone who wants to start a card making blog? Yes, I do have a little bit of advice. I would really recommend that you start somewhere where you can have your blog for free. So, I might not suggest Blogger just because it's a little bit harder to transition from Blogger to a WordPress installation on your own domain, which is what I would hope you would initially would want to do. Like, or not initially, but eventually we'd want to do. So I would say start out at WordPress.com. You can get a free WordPress blog over at WordPress.com. It would be like myblog.wordpress.com or something like that. So I would really recommend doing that. And then once you've kind of established yourself and you know you're going to keep going and you want to put some money toward your blog, then I would say then transition over to your own domain and do a self-hosted WordPress installation, if that makes sense. Like, the free WordPress.com is like, they handle all the back end. They do all the software updates. They do everything for you. But when you do a self-hosted WordPress site, you have to handle the software and you have to get everything going on the back end. Or initially you do, or you need to pay someone to do it. I'm pretty sure you can have a domain with the free WordPress.com, so it looks like a self-hosted. But anyway, so I would say go do something free. And then also get involved with like the blog challenges and galleries, things like that, because that's how people are going to discover your blog. You need to make sure that you're being involved in the community. So like, for instance, when you take a class at onlinecarclasses.com, make sure to post in the gallery, and that'll point back to your new blog that you've just started, and people can see that you're blogging and they can see more of your work. It's a great way to get people's eyes on your blog. Okay, B. Morgan. In fact, I think you asked me to say hello to you while we're chatting. Hello. Do you sign your cards? If so, where do you suggest to put the made by signature? I always put it on the back of the card, usually the back bottom area, but you can put it wherever you want, anywhere in the back panel, I would say. Okay. Camilla, did you ever have problems with re-inking your distress inks? I find they're less juicy after re-inkers. You know what? I don't think I've ever had to re-ink any of them yet. I don't use them a ton, and I have all of them. And so I use all of them a little bit and not one a ton. I haven't had to re-ink any of them. I have used the re-inkers by themselves, but haven't had to re-ink any of them. I would guess, I am not a science person, I do not know this, but I would guess that when you receive the ink pads, those pads are just saturated with ink. And so once they start to get dry and you have to put re-inker on them, even though you're putting on as much as you think you need, I bet it's really not as much as it originally came with, if that makes sense. So if you're finding they dry out really quickly, maybe the next time you re-ink it, maybe put on more than you thought, or put it on, let it sit for a day, put more on, let it sit for a day, kind of see, do a test, like how much ink can it really hold? I don't know. That's what I would probably try. I'm not advising this. I don't want you to ruin your ink pads, but that's what I would try. Okay. This person asks, when you record your videos for voiceover, do you narrate to yourself so you know how long to show items for? No. Not really. I've been doing this a long time, so I just sort of have an idea of how long it might take me to talk about something, or, you know, like at the beginning when I show the stamp set, I kind of have an idea, okay, I'll just leave this on screen for a little bit, you know. But for the most part, I just go for it. I think a lot of it comes with experience. I had someone email me recently asking, how do I get the timing right when I'm doing the narrating and the voiceover? And I basically wrote back and said, it's just a lot of experience and trying it out and really learning your program. Also, a lot of programs have like a timeline at the bottom of the screen so you can see what's coming up next. That really helps when you're doing voiceovers too. Okay. Alicia. What kind of paper am I using for lettering? This is actually just cardstock. This is some Basel cardstock. What color is this? Worms? I think that's the color. Yeah, this is Basel Card Shop. This is the color Gummy Worms, which I think is a really weird name for this color. It's kind of like a grayishy green color. I do not think of gummy worms when I see this. I would think more of like Riverstone or something like that. But I do not pick the names for their paper, so, you know, whatever. Okay. This person's saying, at Target, you can search on your phone, and it'll tell you what aisle it is? What? Yes. You have just changed my life. So it, like, knows your local Target and everything? That's awesome. Okay, so this person has a question about lettering. I always have trouble with the capital M. Could you show how to make yours? Okay. You know, it really just depends on what style you're going for. And I know I've said this a little bit, but like find a font or something that you really love and try to do something with that. Okay, I've got some just black cardstock here. Okay, so for instance, I have a few different M's that I do with brush lettering, but this is probably the one that I use most often, and it's just a really basic M. Just like I'm, oh sorry, let me get that away from that Twitter thing. Just a really basic M. So just down, down, down. M. If I'm doing a capital M, I might want to change it up a little bit. So I might go like this, come from the one side and then come down, up and then down. You could do something like that. I've also seen some really pretty ones where they have a big like flourish at the beginning. This isn't gonna look very good, but. So if you're doing like a Mr. and Mrs. or something, you're doing Mr. I don't know how to ampersand. Okay, let's see. Something like that. I tend to keep my brush lettering style similar to how I would just normally write. So I would say try that. But if you're trying to make like a really ornate letter, I would say look at fonts and just see if you can kind of mimic that font. Okay. All right. I saw a while back that Simon Says Stamp might be having another retreat. Have any details been released for that yet? I don't think any details have been released, but stay tuned. I think it's very soon that they'll be announcing that. Okay, this person asks, can I use a normal brush and acrylic paint to do brush lettering? Absolutely. You can use whatever paint you want. You can use whatever brush you want. That's what's so fun about brush lettering is that you can use practically anything under the sun to do some brush lettering. So, yeah, if you have it, use it. Okay. Also, with writing my name in the font, could you write my name to see what it looks like when others write it? I think your name was just Bree, right? Okay. Capital B's are sometimes hard for me just because they've got a lot going on. You know, they've got two loops. There's just a lot going on with it. So I might have to try out a few different things. All right, non-slanted. You can do like just regular writing and have it put a little downward pressure on it. So I think it's kind of fun. Okay. Do-do-do. This person's asking for their name too, which is Memphis. Here we go with another M. Making sure I'm spelling this correctly. There we go. Okay, thank you. Okay, this person's giving Daphne and Sophie an imaginary hug through the screen. You know what? Sometimes I have to give them imaginary hugs because they run from me. I really have to sit and wait for them to come to me because otherwise sometimes they can be a little skittish. Daphne's getting a little better with that. Like, she'll let me pick her up and whatever. Manny was like, whatever. It was such a cool, mellow cat. Like, you could practically do anything to him. My nephew would, like, sleep on him. And anyway, he was really, really chill and mellow. And I'm thinking maybe Daphne and Sophie will be like that when they're older. Okay, Margie King says, do you ever feel like a celebrity? Yes and no. The only time people really recognize me in public is when I go to CHA, and that might be a little bit to be expected because it's people in the industry, so they'll recognize you and they'll say hello and things like that. I've only had one other time when anyone recognized me, and that was when I went to Michael's that I mentioned earlier to get the wire cutters, and I was in a hurry and I hadn't done my hair and makeup. I was looking pretty atrocious. And you know how when you go up to the counter or they go up to the register and they have you, I think it's your email address or something, so they can send you coupons in the email. Well, I said, oh yeah, here's my email, blah, 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 blah. Well, this lady that was behind me, I think she heard me and she's like, are you Christina Werner? And anyway, I said hello. It was nice, but I felt kind of awkward because I was not presentable. I was just hoping to run into Michael's, get what I needed, and then rush home. It's only when you're not prepared, right? Copic or Zig? What do you mean? Do you mean like for doing calligraphy, doing brush lettering? I would say Zig, just because Copics are more expensive. But they work really well too. I mean, they've got that brush tip. But I would say Zig just because they're a little easier to use. Or do you mean for coloring? Do you mean for like coloring? Like the Zig Clean Color Real Brush Markers? So for a minute there, I thought you were saying Tombow, but it's not. You were saying Zig. You know what? I might still say Copic in that case, just because I have a lot of Copics and I love coloring with them and I want to use them. My clean color markers I haven't used quite as much, although I do really like to use them. Okay. This person says, recently noticed that you use I Love Nail Polish. I'm obsessed with their hollows. What is your fave polish? I really love Fall Semester. It came out last fall. It's beautiful. I think it's that kind of tealishy green one. I love that one. Have you ever used Tombow Dual Tip Brush Markers for brush lettering? Yes, I have. In fact, that's the one that I've got here. I used it earlier in the video. How do you get ideas for cards? From anywhere, everywhere. I really like to look at products and then kind of brainstorm from there, trying to, you know, come up with a way to use the products. So I do take a lot of inspiration from that. Okay, this person says, I was in Dublin, Ireland last week and saw the Book of Kells. Lovely Unical's writing. So inspiring. Do visit if you can. I would love to go there. Absolutely love it. How do you typically write your your uppercase A's? Do you just write them like lowercase A's but just larger? I generally do just make them larger. Sometimes I live adventurously and try to do it differently, but most of the time they're just like this. Just bigger, and then if I've got a smaller A, it'd be like that size. So I just do it like that. But if I try to do something a little bit differently, I might, let's see, how would I do this? I might go like that. That would work. Okay. Persimmon Lulu asks, what brush pens would you recommend for beginners? Can you compare Kuretake Fudobayori and Akashi Sai watercolor brush pens? Okay, so I'm trying to remember if I have that first one you mentioned, because I don't think I've looked at those. Well, actually, I think you're talking about these, because Zig is, yeah, Kuretake. So it's this one, these markers, versus the Akashi Sai, which is these. The Akashi Sai have a real brush. Let me open these up. In fact, we will compare these to the Zig Clean Color Real Brush at the same time. Okay, so I have this one right here. Let me get some paper I can write on. Okay, so it has a real brush tip. I don't know if you see that. Like, I'm getting some dry areas. That's because it's a real brush. And if I slow down, then I can get more solids. So that's really nice. These actually have a felt tip, a felt brush tip. So you're never going to get, like, those really dry strokes. It's always going to be really smooth. And these, the ones I have are the metallic versions. I don't have the regular color ones, so I can't really comment on those. Okay, and then now we're going to look at the Zig Clean Color. And I've got to find one that's open. Because I've been opening them as I use them. Okay, here's a pink one that's open. This one, these have a very similar tip to these. Here, let me go like this. Very, very similar tip. The Zig Clean Color has a slightly smaller tip. So, like, I'm going to press that down as much as I can. And then I'll press this one down as much as I can. You can see the width difference. That's because of the length of the brush tip. So I find them both to be really nice brushes. Like, they're very similar. If anything, I would say that the Clean Color, just comparing these two, the Clean Color is slightly less saturated. Like this one, I feel like there's ink coming out really well. And then on this one, I can't go quite as fast without having as much skip, if that makes sense. But I do like both. I think for travel, just because I have the really big set of the Clean Color, I might take the Akashi aside just because there's less colors, but it's more compact. You could do the same by just picking out what ones you want, I suppose, out of the Clean Color, but that's just my opinion. Okay, can you write my name? I will do your first name, Tina. I'll do that. That's half of my name. T0 is hard because I don't really have a fancy way to write them. But that's how I would write Tina. If any of you are in the YouTube chat and you see questions, if I could have one of you copy and paste them over to Twitter so I can see them, that would be great. Because I can actually see the hashtag Twitter comments through the live streaming software that I'm using, so it's a little bit easier to see questions over here. Okay, this person asks, do you prefer real brush tips or felt brush tips for lettering? You know what? Either one. For ease of use and just like picking up and going, I really like the felt tip. Just because there's no skipping, I don't have to worry about it. They seem to be slightly easier to use, and they can handle a little bit more abuse. You can put a little more pressure on them. Generally, you can write larger with them. They're also metallics. I have yet to see a metallic brush tip. I think that would be really interesting. But the real brush tips for markers, I haven't used them a ton. I find them to be a little bit finicky, but I do love them. You know, it's hard. It really just depends what mood I'm in. Some of you pen enthusiasts will understand what I mean by this. Depending on the paper, depending on the day, depending on the time of day, it determines what pen you're in the mood to use. So it really just depends. Like, there's a lot of like different factors involved. But I do really love both types. Okay, this person asks, which color combo would you suggest for Copics to start with? Like, best colors for brunette and blonde hair. I don't have colors for you off the top of my head. I would recommend, like, going to people's blogs and seeing the colors they use and then write them down. That's what I did when I was, like, picking out colors to buy, because I didn't know what colors I wanted. So I would go on YouTube or I'd go on blogs and I would just look for different color combinations to see what I liked best, if that makes sense. And then just go from there. I really, really recommend doing that because I don't have any numbers off the top of my head. Okay. From YouTube, ask her about collaboration with Tim Holtz on the Bird Crazy accessories. Can we expect more in the future? T0 Tim just contacted me. He'd seen my card from a while back with the bird, with the party hat and the deflated balloon. And he was wondering if I could do additional things for the birds in that same style, because it was really close to the original bird illustration style. And I said, sure, absolutely. I'd be so honored to do that. And so I did that one. We just left it at that. He knows I'm busy. He's busy. I don't know. It's just up in the air. I don't know. Okay. How many cards do you make in a week? Do you make some that you do not video and send to your friends and family? Every once in a while, if I need a card on the spur of the moment and I don't have one already made, I'll go ahead and make one really quick. And I don't bother setting up the camera and filming just because it's a little faster not to. But that's pretty rare. Most of the time I try to really think ahead and know what I would want or need. Like if I have a birthday in the coming up weeks, I would do a birthday card for a video. I really try to make it so I'm using all the cards that I'm showing on camera. So generally, you know, I'll make 3 cards a week. If I'm prepping for a class, sometimes I'll make more than that. And generally class cards, I don't send out. I keep those because, you know, I'm trying to protect class content. You know, like you guys pay money for these classes. I don't want to like be sending out cards that anyone can see and whatever. I don't know. I just feel weird about that. I'd like to protect the class content, to make sure that it's brand new and people don't see it unless they've taken the class, if that makes sense. Okay. How do you do dip nib calligraphy? Or wait, do you do dip nib calligraphy too? We'll have to see a little bit of that one day. You know, I have in the past, I find it a little bit more finicky, a little more difficult than just using a marker or a brush with paint, because that I know it's always going to work. But with this, like pointed pen tips and things like that, you have to find a really good nib. It depends on the paper. There's a lot more involved. I think it's pretty and gorgeous, and you really have to have a steady hand for it. I just find that this brush lettering is a little bit more fun for me, but I really do love it. Okay. I started lettering about 6 months ago and love the Tombow, Fude, and Pentel sign. Do you like or use these as well? I think this is one of the sign ones, right? The touch sign ones, I think. And it's an interesting one because it has like this tip on it. It's kind of like a rubber tip, but you can do some like thicks and thins with it. But they're really small. So it's good for like addressing envelopes or, I'm just going to write Memphis again because that was a fun one to write. Ta-da. Okay. So I have tried these. Let's see. I don't know if I know about the Tombow one. I'll have to look into that one. What does your day-to-day normal handwriting look like? Not as nice as the other stuff. Just regular, like, it can be messy. I wonder if I have something around here that I've written. Hold on. Let me see. Let me see if I have a post-it on my desk. I don't have anything that I can show. All I have are like to-do lists for upcoming things, so I can't show you guys. Like that. Like regular handwriting. Sometimes it can get really messy like that. And I skip letters. I don't know. This person asked, have you been to Japan? If you visited, what would you buy? I've never been to Japan. I always thought I would love to go because it's such a beautiful country. What would I buy? Gosh. I've heard of these amazing stationery and office supply stores in Japan. So I would just love to go to one of those and just raid all the shelves. I would love that. Okay. Oh, another question about the collaboration with Tim Holtz. I answered that earlier. Another question about Tim Holtz. Can you show us how you do the twirls on the first and last letters of the word? You know, I'm always trying to do better flourishes. I think a lot comes with practice, but I'm always trying to do them. Well, there are people out there that are much better at it than I am. Okay, so we'll just turn this right here and I'll do some on the side. I generally, like, if I'm thinking about it, like, okay, I'm going to do the letter C, I think in my mind, how would this flourish look with the letter C? So I try to envision it. I might, like, kind of do some strokes with my hand over the paper, not touching, just trying to get a feel for what I want it to be. And then, you know, after I've got it envisioned, I might go like that. So, like, if I was going to do Christmas or something. And then if I'm going to do when going across, I want to make sure there's room for that I. So like that. So I might do something like that. If I wanted to add one to the at the end of the word, I would think ahead and say, okay, I'm only going to come to like right here and then I'll take it up or something like that. Maybe do a loop. So you kind of have to stop and think ahead, if that makes sense. And also look how other people have done it. Like, look up some reference photos online or Instagram. There are a lot of awesome calligraphers on Instagram. You might do that too. This person asks, how do you use distress inks and what are your favorite brush letter pens? Instead of getting into a lengthy description of distress inks on this video, I would probably recommend that you do a search on YouTube for distress inks and you'll see a lot of different techniques. I know that Jennifer McGuire did a series back in the day for Two Peas, which is still on the Two Peas YouTube channel, and it was just different things to do with inks. So that's a really great resource. Also, if you really want to learn how to use distress inks and all the distress products in this product line, Tim Holtz Creative Chemistry 101 over at Online Card Classes is an awesome resource. You learn straight from Tim how to use those products, and he's a fantastic teacher. Everyone that I've spoken to absolutely love that class. Just, you know, make a mental note in the back of your mind that it is specifically for Tim's product line. You're not going to be learning about other types of inks in that class. It's purely distress. Okay, this person says, can you please write my name? I'm 14 and I really want to learn how to do a nice signature. Okay, so signature is a little different from brush lettering, but let me do the brush lettering first. And it's Emily with an IE, right? Two L's? Two L's. Okay. And as far as like regular handwriting, because I don't think you'd write like that for your signature. Let me see if I can do it on this white, but in something thicker so you can see it. That might work. Okay. So that's just like my regular cursive. So what I usually, well, what I've done, and I totally got this from my mom's signature, is that I always do like a little flip like that, the beginning of my signature. So if you were to do set, like something, you were like, you could do something like that. So it's like a loop, 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 Oh, hello. I totally messed that up. Like that. You might try something like that. I think that could be really pretty. You've got lots of really pretty loops in your name. It'll look really nice. This person asks, what is the difference between Spectrum Noir markers and Copic markers? I don't have any Spectrum Noir markers to show you. So I'd like to recommend that you go check out a video by Bailey Joy, I think, on YouTube. You can actually just put in, I think it's like Copic marker alternates or something like that. Look for, like, alternates for Copic markers or Spectrum Noir plus Copic, things like that. It'll pop up. She's got a ton of views on it. It's a fantastic video where she compares, like, I want to say like 8 or 9 different types of markers and compares them across the board. And the thing that I found fascinating was that when she broke it all down, you're not saving any money by getting other types of markers. You're better off buying Copic Chow markers, basically, because you can refill them or re-ink them. And the cost breakdown, I mean, it just comes, you might as well just get Copics if you're going to invest in markers. Okay. How important is it to leave a link back to something you created just so it doesn't look like a copycat? What? How important is it to leave a link back to something you created just so it doesn't look like a copycat? You mean like you've created something that was inspired by something else? I think that's just common, like, internet etiquette and courtesy, just to say, hey, this was inspired by this person or whatever. Generally, if someone sees your work and they're like, wait a minute, it looks something like that, you know, Susie over here did, it can look a little shady. But if you say, hey, this was inspired by Susie's car, then they're like, oh, cool, that's cool. And then they'll go see Susie's car too. Like, it's somewhat, I mean, you're not directly copying or being inspired by them, but I think it's just common courtesy to do that. Let's see. Off topic, how much did Maddie's Legacy earn for your local shelter? I miss him. I miss him too. I want to say it was just over 10 grand. I think it was, you know, like 10,200 or that. It was amazing. I couldn't believe it. And I heard from the shelter, or the organization that it was for, that right before my friends put up that fund, that they were going to have to start doing some funding so that they wouldn't have to put down any animals. So came in at just the right time, and it was hooked up straight into their PayPal account. So as you guys were donating, it went straight to the animal organization, and they were able to start using the money right away. So it was really fantastic. It was amazing. Okay. This person says, embossing on vellum flakes off. Suggestions? How about tips for crisp embossed images? Mine don't always come out smooth. I would say if your embossing's coming off the vellum, maybe don't do embossing. Maybe do like stays-on ink. Like if you're going to do like metallic stays-on or white stays-on, that shouldn't flake off because it's an ink. So I would say that. And as far as crisp embossed images, make sure you're using a powder tool. That really makes it so that you have a nice crisp image. Also, make sure that you have a good embossing powder. I've seen, oh, and paper too. I think it's like the perfect storm. If you don't have a good embossing powder, a good paper, a good heat tool, a good like pre-embossing like ritual, like wiping it down with a powder tool or whatever, I think you really kind of have to experiment to get the best results for your situation. But I know for me, I always do the powder tool, or I try to always do, if I remember, powder tool on top of some nice cardstock, Versamark ink for the stamping, and I also tend to use Hero Arts white embossing powder or Ranger ultra fine clear embossing powder. I've heard the Simon Says Stamp white embossing powder is also fantastic. I haven't tried it yet. I have it, but I have that whole big container of Hero Arts white, and I don't want to mix the two, so I haven't tried it yet. But I've heard that one's a really good one too. Okay, this person's saying, have you tried writing in a Japanese calligraphy brush? I don't think so. I don't think I have. What type of thermographic powder do you use? Have you tried any from Thermoboss? Talking about embossing powder? I think he just went over that. But I haven't tried that brand. When you're not filming, making a card, or coloring, do you have TV shows or music in the background? I usually do have music in the background. Currently, I'm obsessed with Tori Kelly. I think she's relatively new on the scene. I saw her on The Late Show with, Tonight Show with Jimmy Fallon. I love Jimmy Fallon. I saw her on there how long ago was that? It was a few months ago. And I was like, I really like her. And so she was in the back of my mind. And I was listening to Pandora, like Today's Hits Radio or something. And one of her songs popped up. I'm like, oh yeah, that's that girl from Jimmy Fallon. So then I looked her up and bought her album. So fantastic. I'd really recommend her. She's like a pop, kind of a pop sound, I would say. One of her songs, I can't remember the name of it. Let me look it up on my laptop. She talks about the best Tori that she can be, and she can't be anything other than that. And it's such a good message, I thought. Okay, let me scroll down. It is... oh gosh, I don't know. I think maybe it's called Talk. I don't entirely know, but great message. And she has got some rocking hair. She's got some like awesome curly hair. I love it. Okay. Let's see. Can you use brush lettering to use bubble words? Do you mean like doing like a talk bubble with words inside? I think, yeah, you can. Do you want me to like see how you could do it? So if you were going to do like in a bubble or something. I have to remember, I have to move down here. Okay, here we go. So it might be like, hey, like that. Is that what you mean? Maybe, I don't know. Oh dear. This person asks, how is your planner doing? Can you show us a sneak peek of the pages? I haven't filled it out this week because I've got a couple projects that are really pressing and I know what they are and I don't want to think about anything else I have to do. So I'm sort of like consciously not looking at it. I know that sounds really counterproductive, but in my mind, that is saving my sanity. And this person asks, have you ever done lettering on chalkboards? Any suggestions for lettering with chalk? You know, I haven't, but I did see this amazing chalk lettering wall recently. And I talked to the girl who did it, and I didn't ask her a whole lot about it. I just noticed that it looked really, really awesome. I do know a lot of people who do chalk lettering. They'll start it with pencil. Or they might even use like a projector to like project the design onto the chalkboard and then use a pencil and write it in. I know you can do that. All right, I'm going to take a few more questions and then we'll wrap this up. Catherine wants her name written. Okay. Make sure you can see this on screen. That's the longest name I've written today. Catherine, there we go. Okay, this will be the last question. If you are just starting out on calligraphy writing and brush lettering, what are some tips? I went over this a little bit earlier, but I would just say practice a lot, find images online of styles you really love, and just kind of keep them around. Maybe give yourself a challenge. Like I've been doing this quote challenge, which was a 365 project, but let's face it, this is going to take me like 3 years to get through 365. But if you do some sort of challenge, like, okay, I'm going to do one quote per week or something like that, just to keep it on the forefront of your mind, that's always helpful. And then also there are some calligraphy classes out there. There's quite a few actually online right now. So if you wanted to, you could go search for those and find a style of, you know, find the teacher's style. And if you like their style, then take the class from them. They're fantastic. Okay, so those are all the questions I'm going to do today. Thank you guys for participating and putting in your questions. And I hope you got some great... we're going blurry again. There we go. I hope you got some great advice and had your questions answered. Thank you so much for watching. I will catch you guys in the next video. And I will catch you next time.